right, good evening, good evening. If you take your hymn book, 437, sweet hour of prayer, sweet hour of prayer. And if you would, you stand with me tonight as we sing this song, 437, sweet hour of prayer.
Pray. Thank you, Lord, for again the privilege tonight to be here. Lord, what a privilege to be able to sing songs, hymns based on Scripture. And Lord, I hope to be able to sing it, Lord, honestly and truly. And Lord, to not have to sort of just mumble the words, Lord, knowing that there is something between us and you. Lord, we're so grateful that we can have a personal relationship with you based on what Jesus Christ did on the cross under indwelling Holy Spirit. Thank you for each one that's here tonight. Lord, thank you for the giving spirit of these, your people. Lord, we're excited to be serving you and using, Lord, the Seed Line Project to get the gospel out. Take again to use the offering tonight, Lord, for your honor and glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's go to the Lord in prayer at this time. Our Heavenly Father, how good it is to be able to fellowship together with our Lord. Oh Lord, when we think back in days gone by, oh Lord, there had to be a priest, there had to be a sacrifice to come unto thee. But the Lord Jesus Christ did away with all of that when his own body bore upon him the sin, our sin, Lord, and paid the price for us. And he became the mediator between us and thee, so that now, Lord, we can come directly to God in prayer and have no need of a priest or sacrifice. Oh, Lord, how good it is to be able to read thy word, to speak to thee in prayer. Thank you for this precious time we can have together. In Jesus' name, amen.
564, 564, as we sing this hymn of rejoicing, that would you stand with me as we sing about that we have a home in heaven, a home in heaven. 564, in the sweet by and by.
There's a land that is fairer at day, and by faith we can see the far, for the Father waits over the way to prepare us a place on his there. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet.
Our Father, our Tribune.
Come unto him. I hope that you will. Thank you for the ministry of music today. We're going to dismiss our little ones with my wife and Miss Karen. Head on back. All right. Appreciate these ladies working with the little ones on Sunday nights, as we appreciate all of our workers throughout the week, whether it's Truth Trackers or youth group or Sunday school or junior church and nursery workers. All right, different stages of young people being let out, it looks like. All right. All right, very good. Again, thank you for being here tonight. Good to get and have these two young men. Are these Valley View guys here? All right, they've been with us before. Good to have them there from Valley View down in the Northampton area there. Others that are here tonight, and some regularly, some on Sunday nights. Well, we are wrapping up, Lord willing, tonight. Final look at spiritual gifts in about 20, 25 minutes. And so I'm going to invite you to turn your Bible to Romans chapter 12 tonight. Romans chapter 12. And next Sunday is sort of a culmination of Seedline Project. That'll be Friday and Saturday, and then Sunday morning, the dedication service. And our brother Scott Sandy with Seedline is going to be preaching. They won't be here for the evening. You're going to hear from Evangelist Shane Kohlmeiler in the evening service next week. And so excited about that, as he's going to be preaching. And then we're going to transition as we get into April, obviously, focusing a little bit more on
Resurrection Sunday, Palm Sunday, Easter Sunday, what the Lord did for us on the cross. And so sort of wrapping up tonight, again, every time we look at a topic or a book or a study, sometimes it may leave some saying, hey, you didn't cover everything. I still have unanswered questions. We got to do some more. Others may be saying, we went way too long. different reactions. So I realize that we could do a very extensive, long study on spiritual gifts, some of the sign gifts. My goal on this was to give you the basics of what the Bible says. Certainly we've touched on, there's going to be questions obviously on gifts. The Bible, you know, there are quite, I don't understand everything, all right, but what the Bible does say, I believe that we can take from that and understand those kind of things. So again, whether you're here tonight, first time in a while, or you've been with us through the entire several months that we've been looking at, what are spiritual gifts? What does the Bible say these are? Do I have any? How many? How would I know? What am I to do with them? And then as we've looked at what the Bible says and what we hold here as sign gifts, temporary sign gifts, gifts that are no longer active, we've looked at the gift of miracles, the gift of healing, gifts of speaking in tongues, interpretation. We didn't quite get everything done last Sunday night, but again, all of these are available for you online on our church website. All right, or through YouTube, you can go back and re-listen, or if you missed any, go back and listen again and say, I'm interested in that. I wasn't able to be here. I was sick. We were out of town. I'd like to hear more of what he said and listen, and you can agree, disagree, search the scriptures, and I would encourage you to do that. My goal tonight is to very quickly summarize the speaking in tongues and the sign gifts and wrap up this series by speaking primarily on using your spiritual gifts for the Lord. I'd like to just the last 10 minutes be on that, using your spiritual gifts to the Lord, because sometimes I probably do this often, and I need to work on this, and others do, where we can discuss what they are, blah, 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 give you the information, but never apply it, and you're like, but I don't know what mine are, and I don't know what to do with them, and I learn more maybe, but I don't really know if what they are and how to know and what to do, so I'm still in the same boat, other than the fact that I have a little more information, but I'm still not very confident on what and where and how to use those. So I want to wrap up tonight by how to use your spiritual gifts for the Lord, but let me just take a few minutes here and again, take a little bit of look as we finish up on what are called sign gifts. Last week we were in Acts. We could easily go back to Acts, but we'd be there the entire time. We were looking at Acts 2, at what is Pentecost, looking at as those disciples and followers were praying in that upper room for up to 10 days. And then the Bible says on the full Pentecost was fully come, that was the first day of the week on a Sunday, the Lord came, and we looked at that marked by certain things right there, some of the different signs here of what those were. We talked about tongues are only mentioned in really three books of the Bible, Mark 16, Acts, and 1 Corinthians, and we talked about those kind of things. We said that the baptism of the Holy Spirit is not a command given to us. It's not an experience. It's an act of God whereby the believer in Jesus Christ is indwelt by the Spirit of God, sealed to the day of redemption, placed into the church, the body of Christ, once and forever, by the baptism of the Spirit. We said the filling of the Spirit is the enablement for service. That is something that we will revisit at a future date. I really didn't get to that. That's vital, all right? The filling of the Holy Spirit. All right, we're commanded to do. I left you last week with, do you know what the New Testament gives? Could you give me the specific commands for the believer in the New Testament dealing with the Holy Spirit? Some of you probably came up with a few. Maybe you forgot about it. That's okay. Maybe you did it very quickly. You said, I got those. What are some of the commands? The Bible says, obviously, be filled with the Spirit. They're in Acts 5, all right? Be not drunk with wine, but be filled with the Spirit. That's a command. Therefore, if we're commanded to do that, that's not something that automatically happens. And so there are some people who confuse the baptism of the Holy Spirit, which is a one-time, the moment of salvation, with the filling of the Holy Spirit, which is a command which I believe is many times based on sin and self and where we're at with the Lord. And so that is definitely something I'm going to be speaking on in the future. Not going to be able to get that in here before Easter resurrection, though, okay? But hopefully you came up with some of the other ones. Walk in the Spirit. That's a command out of Galatians. And you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Some are used more as a negative. Quench not the Spirit. That is a command. You and I as believers are not to quench the Holy Spirit. Grieve not there in Ephesians. That's another command. We are not to grieve. And those, again, could be certainly future lessons. There's a lot there to talk about. And some of that will be covered on Wednesday nights. We're speaking on the Holy Spirit on Wednesday night. So a lot of the things that maybe I'm not getting in here on spiritual gifts, which again is not necessarily all of this, we'll cover on Wednesday nights. I hope you'll be back with us on Wednesday night, all right? We said in the scriptures that tongues is always speaking in actual languages. It's an actual earthly language. It's not something made up. It's not something that no one could possibly know what you're saying, and it sounds just like whatever it is, all right? It's actual languages, and we looked at that there. The purpose of tongues is for God, again, and here's the key, and I'm going to do something I rarely do. At the end of the service, I've got two handouts I'm going to hand out. These are not mine. All right? Someone far better studying the scriptures and gifted. But these are going to be from Pastor Kelly Sensenig. Some of you will know that name, some will not. Pastor Kelly Sensenig is the pastor of Berean Bible in Ephrata, PA. My parents were members there for several years before they moved just due to distance and health. And he speaks regularly at Dr. Griffith's men's conference that some of our men attend. He spoke this last one. He spoke 2 years ago. He speaks there quite often. You could always go online if you'd like, Berean Bible, Ephrata. They have a pretty extensive internet ministry. If you ever walk into his church, they have, similar to our foyer, you'll walk into the foyer. They have a track rack, a lot of tracks. But then there are about three or four more of those filled with all kind of bright colored booklets, all right, pamphlets of various sizes from 5 pages to probably 100 on probably well over, I'm not exaggerating, 100 different booklets and things that he has done studies on that he makes available for anybody in the church. Those are also all online. You can easily access that. You may or may not agree with everything. They're just out there as a ministry. I'm going to pass those out. I want to make sure you understand I'm being careful here. If you go on the website, it says these biblical studies are authorized by Pastor Kelly Sensenig. They are available for download to your computer. Our only request is that you honor the author's years of research and the fruits of his labor by not duplicating these biblical studies without giving the pastor of this assembly proper credit. May the Lord use these studies to enhance the spiritual understanding, wisdom, discernment, holiness, and growth of God's people in these last days. So I'm going to be passing out, it's actually one's a separate sheet and the other one is dual two sides, all right? Two sides. I have the original copies up here and I think they'll be a help and blessing to you. May not answer all your questions, not saying that 100%, you know, everything, you may disagree with some of it, but I'm giving it to you as a resource. I believe it is very helpful, and you can take what he has come up with. He's got scripture on there. He's very careful with the scripture. You can read and study on your own. I'll mention these again at the end. What are these three handouts? One is understanding the book of Acts, which is a transitional book between the Old Testament and the New Testament. So we have to be careful. We don't get all of our theology and doctrine just from the book of Acts, because it is a transitional book as far as for the church. All right, we get yes, there are things in there we want to absolutely apply. It's the Word of God, but we need to understand it's a transitional book going from, and this gives you a lot of it, going from the Old Covenant, the Law, the Synagogue, Judaism, Old Testament saints, to New Covenant, grace, church, Christianity, New Testament saints. And so taking the book of Acts and understanding what's going on in there during this transition of the church, which is brand new. God breaking down the barriers between Jews and Gentiles, all right, into one body. And so what God was doing at that time frame with the apostles and with these gifts, very important to understand. I believe that'll be helpful to you. And then two other things here, and again, they'll be on the same piece of paper. And again, one is what his view is. What his view is. You don't have to agree with this. This is one preacher's view based on the study of the Scriptures, all right, but study the Scriptures. All right? He believes there were nine temporary gifts. Nine. Words of wisdom, word of knowledge, faith, gifts of healing, working of miracles, prophecy, as far as predicting the future, discernment of spirits, divers kinds of tongues, and interpretation of tongues. Don't dismiss it until you look and study and realize it. And then he believes there are nine permanent gifts. Now, there's a lot of disagreement on that one. That's okay to disagree. All right? He believes there are nine today. Ministry, exhortation, giving, mercy, helps, governments, administration, ruling, which is one, teaching, pastoring, and evangelism. Of course, pastor, teacher, evangelism are offices designed for men there. All right? So that's one. He has scripture on all of them. And on the other side, again, I have one of the originals. This is really very good. This is excellent. This has changed maybe a little bit of what I was unsure on. I'm not saying I, but this was something I was struggling with, the different passages in the Bible where it gives several different readings of the gifts, but they don't always agree. And what does that mean? But he has these in perfect order. 1 Corinthians was written first, A.D. 59. 1 Corinthians, and then Romans, A.D. 60. Then Ephesians, A.D. 64. Then 2 Peter, A.D. 66. Then the final book, Revelation, A.D. 96. And has down here the different gifts and what he holds to. So again, it's just a resource. It's not gospel. It's not necessarily the Word of God, but it is based on a lot of study. I think it will be helpful for you to look over it, read it, study it as a family, as husband and wife, and then you can arrive at your own conclusion after based on study. All right? Don't dismiss it just because it may not fit with what you've always thought, but what hopefully you have already studied, and you can take that and use it. So I'm going to pass those out at the end. Again, it's not my work, but Pastor Kelly is very, I'll use this word, gifted in breaking things down in letters and booklets and pamphlets. He has a great ministry at that. If it can be something that can help you, please take advantage of it. You can always go online and look at that. And he doesn't know I'm doing this, so this is not a paid advertisement anyway, all right? But I want to give credit to where credit is due, all right? Now, when we come to the book of Romans, again, we looked at the different book. There are four chapters that primarily are four books that deal with gifts. All right? One is 1 Corinthians, and that's verse chapters 12, 13, and 14. Pretty extensive. That's the earliest book written. All right? And that's the one that talks a lot about the miracles and the healing and the speaking in tongues and interpretation guidelines and things like that. Chapter 13, all right? These will cease. We were reading about 1 Corinthians 13. And then you come to, again, Romans, which we're at right now, we'll look at. And then you come to Ephesians, which basically is giving you the gifted offices that God has gifted the church. Apostles, prophets, we believe those are gone. All right, and then pastor, teacher, evangelist, and then the final one there would be Peter. We'll finish with that. We'll look at that. And then comparing that with the book of Revelation, the final book, the 66th and final book of the Bible, completes the canon of Scripture, canon meaning the rule or standard of Scripture, also the final apostle, the final disciple, John, as he passes off the scene. No more apostles, no more prophets, no more of those temporary sign gifts. The Scripture is complete. That which was perfect has come. Those temporary gifts no longer needed. The transition has been done. The breaking down of barriers is over. One body. And now we have these gifts of the Spirit to God's people to be used in the church, primarily that body, for His honor and His glory until He comes. All right? And so again, that's a short version of maybe a long study. That would be something. And again, can I just make sure you understand this? You don't have to go back to college, but you can do online Bible courses anytime you want if you're interested in growing. Yes, we have services here. We try to teach the Bible in Sunday school, and we have ladies' Bible study. We have men's things, and we have all of that. But there's a lot of the Scripture to cover. And if you go to Bible college, you know, Shane, myself, some of you others, I mean, especially if you're a Bible major, you're taking lots of Bible. You're taking Ambassador more than any other Bible college is going to, you're going to go through almost the entire Bible in classes. You're not going to be rushed, all right? You're going through and you're talking and you're discussing question and answer. It's great. You can do a lot. Again, as long as it's a reputable, good Bible preaching, we can give you some recommendations. You can take courses from home. You don't have to necessarily be going for a certain degree, but you just want to grow in the Lord. I know that obviously here at your church, you had that at one time with Keystone. There's other churches that offer that. That would be a great way to enhance your spiritual growth. Get in the Scriptures, dig and grow, do some papers, do some thinking. All of that's available. That's something that would be interested in you. You also could go back to Bible college. The Lord may lead you to that. Or go for the first time. Absolutely. Think on those. Pray on those. A lot of this stuff is stuff that's hard to get in. You could do it for years just on a Sunday night, 30, 35 minutes, or on a Bible study once a month. But you're going to go a long, long time. Whereas on a Bible course at a college, could be 5 days a week, 3 days a week, 2 days a week on a regular basis and cover a lot of ground. Okay? But let me take these last 10 minutes on this title topic. Using your spiritual gifts for the Lord. If you're in here and you're saved, you have at least one spiritual gift. Be young or be older. I do not know. The Bible does not make it clear that we only have one, or if we could have several. It appears that we could have several to whom much is given, much is required, but I don't know. Therefore, I want to be wise with a wise steward of what God has given me. So I want to give us some practical things here, using your spiritual gifts for the Lord. Before we get to the scriptures, let's read this here. Let's start with this, all right? Romans 12, let's look at verses 3 through 8. 3 through 8, you're in Romans 12. Follow along with me, Romans 12, 3 through 8. Paul, the human author, says, "For I say through the grace..." Wow, given unto me, God has given me special grace as an apostle, as one who's writing the scripture, "to every man that is among you," that's generic, every man, every woman, every believer, not to, remember, this is the key when it coming to spiritual gifts. This is the key, this is why it begins with this. "Not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think." Better be careful on this one, myself, "but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man," every believer, "the measure of faith. For as we have many members in one body, and all members have not the same office, so we being many are one body in Christ, and every one members one of another. Having then gifts," that's definitive, no question there at all. Believers, there you have a gift. "Having then gifts, differing," they're not always going to be the same, "according to the grace that is given to us, whether prophecy," that's not a prophecy of Old Testament prophecy, that's not predicting the future, that's not revealing new revelation, that has ceased. "Prophecy, let us prophesy according to the proportion of faith. Or ministry, let us wait on our ministering. Or he that teacheth on teaching. Or he that exhorteth on exhortation. He that giveth, let him do it with simplicity. He that ruleth," sometimes that's called a government or administration, "with diligence. He that showeth mercy with cheerfulness." I've got 5 quick points here on using your spiritual gifts for the Lord. I could be speaking to folks that still you don't know your spiritual gift. Again, the burden lies on you to not let that lay by the side or on the shelf day after day, week after week, year after year, and not find it. So number one is you need to know and recognize your gift and gifts. How, Pastor Boyer? Study them. Meditate on them. Pray and consider them. Serve and discover them. I say that one again. Serve and discover them. And then learn and go. Yeah, I don't think, it's not, again, we can pray all we want, but as the Bible doesn't say, but we often use in principle, you got to put some feet to your prayers. You can pray all you want, "Lord, give me a job, give me a job, give me a job." But if you expect to just sit at home and someone's going to come knocking on the door and say, "I got a job for you," it's probably not going to happen, all right? You need to get out there. You put your name out, resume, knock on doors, all right? Get out there, all right? If you expect, Lord, I need this. Well, we've got to do that, right? We teach our kids that, I hope, things like that. Well, what about your gifts? "Lord, I need to know my gift. Lord, show my gift. Study the scriptures. Read, meditate. Seek counsel from older, wiser folks there. Come see me. Pray. Search the scriptures. Begin to think. But you got to serve. You're going to serve and find that out. You're going to serve and know, and then you need to learn and go. Number two, you need to thank the Lord for that gift or gifts. And we need to never forget that it is a gift. That is the key. Thank the Lord for that gift. Always thank the Lord on a regular basis. That'll keep you humble. Never forget that it is a gift. That means it's undeserved. It's purely given by God. None of us deserve it. None of us have any special things. God's given it to us. And therefore, that should result in all of us serving the Lord with gladness and humility. As we remember, this is a gift. I don't deserve this. God has given me this to. He's given to me, not for me, but for him to serve. Lord, therefore, I'm going to serve gladly, with gladness and joy, and I'm going to serve with humility. As the Bible says, not to think of myself more highly than I ought to think, according as God hath dealt to every man. All right? That's the key. Number three, I'm going quick, I know. Do not compare yourself with others, though. Do not compare yourself with others, either by lifting yourself up or by lowering everybody else, or by thinking that they have no gifts, because that is not true, all right? So do not compare yourself with others, but rather, here's key, embrace your gift or gifts and use them for God's glory. Let's go over a little bit to your right, 2 Corinthians 10. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. I'm going quick here. I'm watching the clock. I'm going to be careful. I know we dismissed a little bit late because of the prayer time, so I'll give my wife some time to finish up her lesson. But I hope we're not watching the clock, all right? I think it makes church a little more enjoyable, all right? We are aware that to nursery workers and things like that, we want to be conscious of that. But we'll wrap this up as quick as we can. But 2 Corinthians 10, don't compare yourself to others. Don't lift yourself up as if, wow, I have all of this. How come other people can't do this or think like this? Or lower other people by acting as if they're not very gifted or talented or they have no way that they can use. Rather, embrace your gift and gifts. Use them for God's glory. 2 Corinthians 10, verse 7, look at that first question. This, I wish we could get into this whole chapter, but we'll just have to hit a few points. 2 Corinthians 10, 7, speaking to the church. Do ye look on things after the outward appearance? It's a sobering question. Do you and I look on things after the outward appearance? Drop down to verse 12. For we dare not make ourselves of the number, or compare ourselves with some that commend themselves, but they measuring themselves by themselves and comparing themselves among themselves are not wise. They're comparing and measuring amongst themselves by themselves. Verse 13, but we will not boast of things without our measure, but according to the measure of the rule which God hath distributed to us, a measure to reach even unto you. And I know we're not being able to perfectly explain all of this. Now look at verse 17, but if you go back and read this, I think you'll understand it. But he that glorieth, let him glory in the Lord. There was some bragging and boasting. There was some comparing with other church members. Paul has to, they were even making fun of the Apostle Paul and his public speaking, saying that his letters sure are really good and weighty, but he doesn't look or talk or act like a very good speaker. And they were mocking and making fun. And Paul, he's dealing with this. What are you doing? Measuring yourself by yourself and comparing yourself among yourself? Are you boasting? If you're going to glory, let's glory in the Lord, not in anything else. And Paul's having to deal with that. And that's a problem that we can have when it comes to gifts. We sort of compare ourselves with each other, all right, and measure ourselves by each other, making ourselves the standard. And that can bring pride and a critical spirit. Number four, I want to say this again. I want to deal with younger believers and older believers here. It's easy when you're younger, and I dealt with this a little bit at the men's retreat last year, but it's easier when you're younger, not just guys and girls. When you're younger, you have time, you have energy, you have strength, and you have stamina that you will not have your whole life. And it's easier when you're young, and I don't just mean teens now. I'm talking about young adults. I mean, whoever you think is young, 30, 40, 50, that's fine, that's great. Wow, as long as you still have that, it's easy to look down on others maybe who don't have that time, that energy. Now again, we're not saying everybody uses their time wisely. We're not saying everybody physically is doing what God would have so that they do have energy and stamina and health and eating and all that. But just by the process of our bodies getting older and breaking down, younger believers, you need to use the gift or gifts you have with the time, the energy, enthusiasm, and strength you have right now for God's glory, all right? A verse for that, and again, you need not necessarily turn there. If you love to turn to those, that's great. I'm going to read a verse in Proverbs 20:29. It says, the glory of young men is their strength. All right, there's a reason guys sometimes like to shake hands. And the reason guys like to look in the muscles and flex a little bit. I got that, all right? Yeah, the Bible says the glory of young men is their strength. God's given you that strength. Please don't think it's yours. It says God's given it to you, and that's something not to be proud in, but to use for His glory. But the rest of that verse says, and the beauty of old men is the gray head. Now, that's hard to embrace that. Well, I don't know about that one. The beauty of old men or older ladies is the gray head. Oh, no. God says both are great, but you need to understand the time things. Younger believers, God has given you energy, stamina, and strength. But that energy, stamina, and strength and the time is fleeting. You need to say, God, I will use it right now for your honor and glory. What happens is we often use that just for ourselves. And then one day when we get older, we don't have it. We didn't use it for God. Take the gift or gifts you had and use that, and don't look on disdain at others who may not have the time or energy. Hey, I'll get that. Use your energy for the Lord. Don't brag and boast. God's given it to you. He's given it to you to use for His service. He's given you that. He can take it at any moment. Use it for His honor and glory. Now, what about the older believers? Doesn't mean that you're not strong, but listen, as you get older, those things fade. And you get discouraged sometimes. You can't do the things you used to. What do you have? Well, Proverbs 16:31 says, the hoary head, the gray head, is a crown of glory, if it be found in the way of righteousness. There's a condition. The gray head is a crown of glory, something to be proud of, not proud in a boastful way, if it be found in the way of righteousness. If you're a right, it means this, as you get older, you don't have maybe the time like you did, you don't have the energy and the stamina, but you should have this, you should have wisdom, godly counsel, and to be able to be encouragement to the younger generation. And God says you need to use that. Oftentimes our younger ones don't use it for God, and oftentimes the older ones shut down. And God says, no, 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 you can, why can't you encourage some of this younger generation? Say, you can do it. I'm praying for you. I'm here for you. I'm here to come alongside you. God's given me wisdom. God's given me a lot of years. I've learned a lot of things. God's given me much over the years. I might not have all that I used to be able to do. I wish I could. But I can pass on to the younger generation wisdom. I can tell them about God and things I've learned. I can tell them about child rearing and parenting and grandparenting. I can tell them about church and trusting God and trusting with finances. I can do all those kind of things. Time will not let us go to 1 Timothy 5, 2 Timothy 2, Titus 2, where God says the older ladies teach the younger. That doesn't happen anymore. The older men, the younger men, teach the faithful men. God says, you older folks, it is not time to shut it down. It is not time to just act. No, no, it is your duty to pass that on. Well, they're not going to listen. It is your duty to pass that on, all right? It is your duty to use what, combine your gift, both young and old, with the things that God has given you. Number five, and we're done. This is, I think, the key challenge when it comes to our gifts. Because remember, if it's a gift, that means God has given you something that others may not have. Don't take this anyway boastful. I have a high metabolism. You may have noticed that, all right? That's not me. I mean, God's given it to me. I have a high energy. I understand that. I thank the Lord for it. Doesn't mean it's always going to be there. It can be taken at any moment, all right? You know what? Sometimes when you have this, sometimes it's easy to just power through and do everything yourself. I can do it. Or to even sometimes look down, how come they don't have the same energy? Why can't they keep going? Why can't they do those kind of things? And it's easy to become proud, being completely honest, I hope you're honest with people, and the gifts and abilities that you have that others may not have. And yet God doesn't want me to just like, get frustrated with people. How come they can't sustain energy? How come they can't keep on going? How come they can't see things this way? God wants me to realize God has given you that gift or that talent or that ability for His service. Embrace it and use it willingly and say, you know what, not everybody may have this. I can use my energy for the Lord, though. Some of you have know-how. God's given you know-how. You're going to get frustrated with people who don't have know-how. But rather than get frustrated, thank God that He gave that to you and use it for His glory. And not get so frustrated with people who don't think the same way or see the same way or know how to just take a problem and manage it. You've got that gift, baby. Use it for His honor and glory. Rather than say or think, why don't they? Why don't they? Why don't they have the moxie, the wisdom, the sensitive spirit, the giving, the mercy? And again, we're not saying there are areas that can be developed, but there are gifts that God has given. And if you have that gift, it is a gift. And it's from God. And others may not have it. And it will be easy to be frustrated that they don't have it as you may have it. They have one that's different than yours. You get frustrated with them, and they may get frustrated with you. Though you both keep it private, probably, all right? But use it for God's glory. Why? I can use this to be a help and a blessing to folks who can't. One of the things we tried to really push in our teens, and we tried to emphasize this with our parents, is anytime we have a church fellowship, missions, anytime we're in the gym, we had a gym, and we're setting up tables, we better see those teens jumping at it. I mean, we didn't tolerate everybody's putting stuff away and the kids are just playing basketball. And they probably got irritated with that. But hey, what? We're a church family. We're teaching these kids. No. Get over there and do that. Look, we had an older gentleman in our church. He would do it. You've got the energy and the strength. No reason they need to do that. Doesn't mean if they want to. You get there and serve. You get there. Why? You've got energy. You've got strength. You can do it. Do it. All right? Serve the Lord and do it cheerfully. Use what you have to be a help and a blessing to others, to edify the church body, and to bring God the glory. We'll read two verses and we're finished. If you'll turn with me to 2 Peter, the final passage that deals with spiritual gifts. And then we'll be done. And I'm going to have these couple of these guys up here pass out these as we dismiss tonight. I made 50 copies, so I don't have any idea. But it was designed more for one per family. If we have some extras, we'll leave them in the front. You can come back and get those. And you can get those and be dismissed, all right? The last passage here is 2 Peter chapter number 4. This is really the last portion. This is one of the later books written toward the end here, Peter. All right, the end of the getting closer to the end of Scripture. 2 Peter here, look at chapter number, 1 Peter. Some of you are like, yep, you're in the wrong one. That's good. You're like, that's not the right one. All right, good. 1 Peter 4, there we go, verses 10 and 11. We'll let the Scripture speak and be done. 1 Peter 4, 10 and 11. As every man hath received the gift, you'll have to determine what that is through prayer and study and service. As every man hath received the gift, even so minister, serve the same one to another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. Now that sums up spiritual gifts right there. You have a gift, you're to minister and use it to serve one another, and you're to be a good steward of that gift or gifts because of God's giving it to you. Verse 11, if any man speak, let him speak as the oracles of God. If any man minister, let him do it as of the ability which God giveth, that God in all things may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom be praise and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Wow, those are tremendous summary verses on spiritual gifts. A lot packed into those two little verses. Use it for God's glory. I believe with all my heart we're going to stand before the Lord one day and give an account as believers with what we've done with the gift or gifts that God has given us. Were we good stewards of them? Did we use it or them for His honor and glory? And did we do it in a wise manner, a humble manner, as the Lord asked us to do? Okay?